Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Okay, so we are talking about hash function. So it's basically for handle the problem called system table problem. What is the problem? We have given some records, we have given some keys, and we need to arrange this key in a data structure so that we can do some operation in a faster way. That operations are basically insert, delete. So these two makes this set dynamic. So this set T is a dynamic set. So we are keep on inserting some record, we are keep on deleting some records, and the moreover we should able to do the search in a faster way. So we should able to search a record whose key value is K. So that search should be faster way, because this is the, you can relate this to a database problem. We have given some data, big data. So how to search a record, how to search a record in this this database. So that is a search problem. So search problem is very common. Okay, now we have seen two data structure before hash function. We have seen a simple array of say numbers, like if we have numbers like if T is say at some point of time, if T is some T, these are the key values 4, 6, 1, 9, then we use array. Our T is a simple array of these numbers. We are storing this number into this array. So 4, 6, 1, 9, or you can think this as a linked list in order to avoid the static allocation. So now this search time will take linear time, because we are not doing anything on this input, we are not sorting them. So linear time to search. To make it faster, what we have done, we have taken the that symbol table like 01 bits. So instead of this, we have taken this, we have in the next slide. So we have taken a bigger array of size is depending on the size of the key, how much value we are allowing. So here key is starting from 0. So if we are allowing the key value to be m minus 1 up to, then we take a array. This is called direct access table. We take a array, and then wherever the keys are, we will put that corresponding field to be. If we have a key like 100, if we have a record whose key is 100, so we will put the this field to be 1. So this is presence or absence. Very nice data structure. 01 bits. So just a bit vector, you can see. Just by the single bit, we can represent the presence or absence. So we can put 0 if it is absent, we put 1 if it is present. So very nice data structure and very faster. So that way, so if our key contain 100, then we have a 1 over here, and if 2020 is not there, we have a 0 over here. So like that. So this we have discussed in the last class. This data structure. So if 2020 is not there in our record, that means we don't have any record whose key value is 2020, then we put a 0 over there. That means absence. So this is 1 or 0. So this X is the record. I mean, the record is present in that field. So that is the thing. Now, this is very faster in the sense that insert, delete, and search. If we are searching a key whose if we are searching a key 50, so what we do, we go to T50, which is here, this one, we go to index 50 in this array or in this table. So we go there, we'll check whether this is 1 or 0. If it is 0, then the record is not present there. That means we don't have a record whose key value is 50. So very fast, it's a linear time. Just we go there and we just fetch, we just get that. So now similarly insert also, to insert we go, if we have to insert 50, if we have to insert a record whose key value is 50, so we go there and we make it 1. Here we are allowing all the keys are distinct, because if they are same keys, we have only one space to store 0 or 1. So there is no way we can accommodate 2% over here. So that's why we assume that keys are distinct. Okay. So now this has a drawback in the sense that if we have a data size is very huge, like number of keys are less. Suppose we have only say 10 keys or say 4 keys. This is our set of keys. Say number of keys are less, 4, 1, then say 4. Then suppose suddenly we have a key like 4, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, very big. In general, if we allow the 64-bit numbers, so M is 2 to the power. So M, if it is 64-bit numbers, any binary bits of 0, 1 can be a key of 64 bits. So that means what is this M? M will be 2 to the power 64, because that is the each of this key can take 64 bit. So we are allowing each of this key to be 64 bit number. So each number can be 0 or 1. So what is the maximum value? If all are 1. So if all are 1, it is 2 to the power 64 minus 1. So M is 2 to the power 64, which is nothing but this big size. So that is the size of the array we need to maintain in order to have this direct access table. So that is the drawback of this data structure. Although this data structure is very fast, very cool data structure, but this is a problem if the our usually key is very big. I mean, that is the goal of this hash function, that we have a bigger size, because our password, all these things could be anything. We can have a poem as our password. So if you convert into binary, it will be a big string. It could be more than 64 bit also, but our computer can have only some fixed size register. So if it is say thousands bits, then how to convert into some 8 bit or something? So that will use the hash function for doing that. So this data structure, we are for this drawback, we are going to see the alternative. Alternative is the hash function. So what is a hash function? Hash function is a function which takes any, this is the set of keys, I mean universe of keys, set of all possible keys. If it is 64 bits, say all 64 bits numbers are here. So how many numbers are there? All 64 bits number means we have, so each is a 64 bit number, say 0, 0, dot 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 1, this is 164 bit number, this is one key, this is a K1, then another number maybe 0, 1, dot 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 1, like this. So all 64 bits number, if our key size is 64 bit, it could be any arbitrary size. So this U is nothing but set of all possible keys, or we say this is universe of keys, universe set, universe of all keys. Okay. So if it is 64 bit, then we have 2 to the power, size of U is 2 to the power 64, which is huge. This key space is very much bigger. But at some point of time, if you take the snapshot of our record, we don't have all the keys in our record. We have, among these, we have only few keys, which is K set. We have only few keys, which is we have the K set. K is the our records, our records of our interest. So that set may be less. I mean, we may have 64 bits, each key may be 64 bit, but we can have only 100 keys. Each of these 100 keys are 64 bit. That value is huge, but the n is the number of keys. The K size, this K is the number of keys to be considered. So this n, this size cardinality of this set is n may not be so large. If n is also large, we cannot handle this. Okay, so now what is a hash function? Hash function is a function which, any function which can which takes the U as a domain and which takes the codomain as our fixed size. So we have a array size of 0 to m minus 1, 0 to m minus 1. So if we take any key from here, if we apply this function, it should, this is the codomain. So this is the value. So this is the table or array. So 0 to m minus 1. So it should give us one of these values. So that is called, any such function is called hash function. So if we have given such a function, so what is our data structure? What do? We just apply the function. Sorry. So we have a h1. So we apply, we have a k1, the first key to be inserted into the table to store in the data structure. So we apply h of, we apply h on that. So it will be hitting to some of this slot. Okay, so that we will put the k1 over here in that table, in that slot. Similarly, we have another key k2. We apply the hash function, it is sitting here. So that is k2 will be sitting here like that. So this way we continue. So if you have n keys, we have to apply the hash function n times. So like this. So we are going smoothly until we have a problem like this. Like this. So k2 was sitting here. So this is an ith key, ith slot. So k2 is sitting here. Now if we have another key k5, which is mapped to the same slot, which is not free, which is already occupied by some other key, so then that situation is called collision. And collision is quite natural, as we have said, because this function h is basically a function from bigger set to smaller set. And this cannot be a one-to-one function because this cardinality of this set is very huge. This is u and this is just the table size. I mean, this cardinality of this is m and cardinality of this set is very huge. If it is 64 bit, then it is 2 to the power 60. And this m is, if we are mapping to 8 bit, if we have any 64 bit key, we are mapping into 8 bit. So what is m? M is 2 to the power 8. So we have 0 to 2 to the power 8 minus 1. So that size is very less. So there has to be some collision. We cannot say, okay, we have a collision free hash function, something like that. So that is not acceptable because this set is bigger, this set is smaller. We have to have, we cannot construct a one-to-one mapping on that. Okay, so collision is, collision will be there because this K2 and K5 are mapping to same slot. And here we, this is a one, only one array. So we cannot accommodate 2% there. So for that, what we need to do to handle this collision, we have seen the chaining method. So chaining is basically, we need to have some storage outside the table. So this is the storage outside the extra array, or you can say linked list. Okay. If we make it dynamic, you can use linked list. If you want to make it statically, you can have a two-dimensional array. With some reasonable size of the initialization. Anyway, so we are using a linked list. So we have a list for, so this in the ith slot, these two guys. So in the ith slot, these two, this 49 and 86 and 52. So all are mapped to this. All are mapped to this ith slot. Their each values are same. So that is called collision, right? So their age values are same, their hash values are same. So in that case, we need to have a table, we need to have a linked list outside the table. That is called chain. So you need to have a chain outside the table. And so this is the chaining method to handle the collisions. Now, how to analyze this? Analyzing of chaining. So we say our hash function is a simple uniform, simple uniform hashing, or it is a good hash function if we can distribute the keys. We have n keys over here. This is n, k is equal to n. This is the k set, cardinality is n, and we have m slot over here. If n keys are distributed over this m slot uniformly, that means probability of any keys, given a key will be coming into one of this slot is 1 by n. So if that is the case, then that hash function we have we called a good hash function or uniform, simple uniform hash function. Sorry. So then in that case, what is the time complexity? If we define this n to be the number of keys and n to be number of slots, and we have this alpha. Alpha is basically n by n. And if we assume our hash function is uniform hash function, uniform simple uniform hash function, then on an average each slot will contain this number of keys. So this is the average number of keys per slot, because that is the assumption we are making on the hash function. Our hash function will distribute these keys uniformly. So in that case, the time complexity for searching will be this, because first we have to, if we have to search, so we have this array, we have these tables. So these are sizes m, and we have this k size, this is k, n. Now we are searching a key, whether key is there or not. So what we have to do, we have to apply the hash function. We have to apply the hash function, it will hit to some of the slot, ith slot say. Then in that we have to go for the, because collision will be there, we are expecting, go for the chaining, I mean go with the chain, and this chain size is alpha, because we have taken the good hash function. So in that case, this is the order of 1 plus alpha, that is the search time or insert time or delete time. So now when is the worst case is if all the n keys are colliding into same slot, that is the worst case. So in that case, so the size will be n in this list size will be n. So in that case, so this will be dominating, this will be order of n, so that search time will be order of n, which is not good than the linear search in an array. But if we are lucky, I mean in that sense, if our hash function is good hash function, then this is a, if we take n, m and n, if n is if n is order of n or m is order of n, then both are, sorry, order of n. In that case, we have so alpha will be in that case constant, alpha will be order of 1. If we are using the good hash function, because alpha is the m by n. But if worst case, it is always you have all the keys are mapped to the same slot, so that is it. Okay, yeah, so now we will see some construction of hash function, or how to choose a hash function, and whether this is a good hash function or bad hash function, that we will discuss now. So the assumption is the assumption for the simple hashing is the that is very hard to guarantee, because we cannot guarantee that. We are expecting that will be distribute the keys uniformly, but there are several common techniques in practice which we have seen. I mean, this could be a good construction, something like that. So that those are all heuristic, not the deterministic. We cannot guarantee, we cannot prove that this will give a good mapping, because we have no control on this set K, the key set. Okay, so this is the desirable. A good hash function should distribute the keys uniformly into the slot of the table, and this should have a uniform distributions. So let us have some example of hash function. So this is the first example, which is called division method. Or so what we do, so suppose here we have dealing with the integers, so we have the key set, and we have a fixed slot or array which is starting from 0 to m minus 1. So our array size, table size is m, and here we have a key size. So key is any number, integers, any big integers, that is our key. Okay, so what is our hash function here? So our hash function is just the mod function, because if we take any integer, if we have to output the integer which is 0 to m minus 1, so the easier way to do the division, and the remainder will be our less than m. So that, any question? Any question? I request you to mute your mic if you are not asking the question. Yeah, so I have muted all. Okay, so here what we do, we have a fixed size of the table size is fixed, which is 0 to m minus 1, and we have the key which is any integers, say some integer 1, 0, 5, 9, 3, 1, any integer could be our keys. Okay, so now we want to make it, so the easier way to take the mod, the division, So if you take any integer, if you want to put it, if the want to output the 0 to m minus 1, we easier way to take the mod. So we take the mod. Okay. Now the question is whether this is a good hash function, or because if you take any keys, it will map to one of this slot when we take the mod, because mod means we divide this by m. Suppose m is say 100. So our table size is 0 to 99. So whatever the key we have, the h of that will be, has to be 0 to 99. So the if we took the mod of 100 on that keys, any keys, it will give us remainder 0 to 99. Now the question is, we have to analyze this hash function, whether this is a good hash function or bad hash function. So for that, we need to see the collision, the size of the collisions. So that we have to check. So for that, let me erase this. Yeah, so now the problem is, if we choose, usually m is 2 to the power r. That is the very common practice, because our keys are some bits, big bits, so l bits, and we have to apply the hash function. This is the key. You have to apply one key. You have to apply this hash function to make it smaller size, say r bit. So this is say m bit, this is say l bit. So this could be say 64 bit, and it could be say 9 bit, like that. So usually we have these situations. We have this situation in practice, that we have our key size is some bits, L bits, or L bits, and our table size is. So what is M? M is, if it is R bits, what is M? So what is our table? Tables are R bits. So what is the possibilities? All are 0, so that is the 0. Then last bit is 1, that is 1, like this. So what is the last one? So all are 1s. So that is 2 to the power r minus 1. So that is our m. So m is, so this size is 2 to the power r minus 1. If our table is r bit. So 2 to the power. So these all are, so this is the m. So m is 2 to the power r. Now if we have this situation, so what is the drawback? Any drawback you can feel? Suppose we have a key like this. So key is, say key is any size, so key is L bits, and our R is 6 bits. Now if we take this mod of this 2 to the power R, then what will be the h of k? H of k will be this. If you observe this, this is basically last 6 bit, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This last 6 bit. Why it is so? Can you tell me why it is so? Anyone? Our k is this. So k is some L bits. How many bits? So 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So k is 16 bits. Keys we have to map into 6 bits. We have to compress into 6 bits. So now if you take an arbitrary key, this one, and if you do the 2 to the power 6 on this, we will get the last 6 bit. Why it is so? Any idea?
Sir, because from the
same bit, we have 2 to the power 5. Always divisible by 2 power 6.
Yeah, because if we convert into decimal system, it is nothing but this plus 2. So this is say, if we just represent this as x0, x1 like this, x2, x3 dot 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 like this. So this k is nothing but, in the decimal system, this is x0 plus 2x1 plus 2 square x2 dot 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 up to 2 to the power 5, I mean x6 into 2 to the power 5, and then we have 2 to the power 6, we can take common over here. So we have some values over here. Now if you do the mod 2 to the power 6, then this will vanish and only this part will be remaining. So this part is nothing but x0 to x6. Okay. So that is the very simple way. So that means, so what is the problem with that? Can you see the problem?
Sir, if bits are less than 6, it will always go to 0.
If bits are less than 6, it is always go to 0. That is one problem. But bits are, so how many are, any other problem?
The first two, are, even if the first two bits, 12 bits are different, there doesn't show any difference in the output.
Yes. So how many are there? So that means, if we fix these bits, if we fix these bits, this last, if we fix this last R bits, and if we change these bits, they are all mapped to the same slot. There, how many bits are there? L minus R. So this is a huge number. So this all L minus R, if we fix these bits and if we change any bits over here, they all map to the same slot. So that is basically 2 to the power L minus R. So these all are mapping to the same slot. So huge collision is happening. So this is all the bits of all the keys over here whose last R bits are fixed. Only things we have a, so say we change this to be 0. So they will map to the here, change this to be 0, they will map to the here, the, it will map here, so it will map here, it will huge collision. So all are mapping to the here, whether this we are fixing, this slot is 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0. So that is the problem. So we have a, so this cardinality of this set is 2 to the power L minus R. Now, if we choose L to be large, R to be small, this is a huge numbers. So, all are colliding in the same slot. It's not a uniform distribution. So, we have a chain in that slot will be, that is the drawback of this. So, for that, if we are very much fan of using the division method, so we need to choose this, so we need to choose this M, we need to choose this R to be, or M to be a prime number, or which is prime number which is not close to some 2 to the power R, or 2 to the power R you are dealing with the binary system, it could be decimal system also. Yeah, so M we choose to be prime number to, in order to get the better result, I mean better hashing, that means uniform hashing, which is not close to a power of 2 or power of 10 if we are decimal system we are doing. Okay. And we have seen that that is also heuristic. We cannot prove that because we have no control on the key set which will come. So heuristically people have seen that this is a good hash function if we choose to be M to be prime, or which is not close, which is prime close, not close to the some power of 2 but power of 10. But it is, as I mentioned, that it is very much, practical to choose the this M to be 2 to the power R, because usually we have a arbitrary length message. In cryptography, we do the, like this, we have an arbitrary length message. We have to compress this into a fixed length using the hash function, smaller length. So that is the. So usually, in usual practice, we cannot avoid M to choose 2 to the power R. So next, we are going to use another hash function where we are allowed to take M to be 2 to the power R. So that is called multiplication method. So here we are allowed to take M to be 2 to the power R. So our M is 2 to the power R. That means our table is 0 to 2 to the power R minus 1. 0 to 2 to the power R minus 1. Okay. Now what we do, our key size is, our key is all are W bits key. Each is W bit. And we have given a W bit, we need to convert into R bit. So that is our hash function. So we have given a W bit number. This is W bit. And we need to map it into R bit. R is obviously very much less than W. Okay. Now what we do? We choose a constant A. A is a constant. So we choose a constant A, which is also W bit. Now we multiply A with K. K is a W bit number. 0, 1. So what is the size? Cardinality of this set? 2 to the power W. Bit number, then what will be the size? It will be 2W bit. So we are multiplying this binary multiplication, you can say. So we have A is a W bit what? Binary number, K is the key, which is W. A is a constant we are choosing. So now this, if we multiply this, it will again be a 2W bit. Now we want to make it W bit. What we do? We take the mod of 2 to the power W. So then it will be again become W bit. And then we will do the right shift. How many times? W minus R times. Then it will give us a, we are shifting, we are just discarding the bits. We'll take an example. Then it will give us a R bit number. So let us take an example, then it will be more clear. Suppose our W is 7. So our key is 7 bit and we need to convert into 3 bit number. So our keys are 7 bit numbers, any 7 bit number is our key, and we need to choose a hash function which will map to this to 3 bit. This is 3 bit. Okay. So now our aim is 2 to the power 3, that is 8. So our table size is, our array size is 0 to 7. So anything we need to have, we need to convert into 0 to 7. Now we choose a A. So A is a constant we can choose. So we are choosing A, which is W bit, which is 7 bit. Okay. Now what is our hash function? Our hash function is, we take a W bit key, which is say this one. We multiply with A. We multiply with A, that is the first step. Now if we multiply two W bit numbers, then it will be 2 W bit. So this is 7, 7. So it will be 14 bits. So this is the multiplications. If we do this binary multiplication of these two number, binary numbers. Okay. Now after that, what we are doing? We are doing the right shift, right shifting. We are discarding the bits. First we are doing the 2 to the power W to make it again W bit. So if you do the 2 to the power W, then last 7 bit will come, last W bit. So this is the last W bits. So we just discard these bits. And then we are doing the right shift of W minus R. So W is 7, R is 3, so 4 times. So if you discard, if you do the right shift 4 times, so this will go, this will go, this will go, this will go. So ultimately this will be remaining. So this is our H of K. So H of this K is, H of this number is 0, 1, 1. So 0, 1, 1 means we can go to that slot and we can put this key over here. So that is the our hash function. So this is heuristically, it is can be observed, this is a good hash function because of this. This is basically the modular wheel. So what we are doing over here, once we are multiplying, so we have a key. We don't know which key is this is. I mean, we don't know the value of this. So we have chosen a constant on this wheel. So that is our A. A is a constant we are choosing. Now the key we have no control, but if we do the 2A, so it will be like this. So we are just, this is 2A, then 3A. So this is, we are throwing the wheel and it is going to some point over there like this, because this is a modular wheel. And it is, it has been observed that, this is a good hash function. Like, again, heuristically, we cannot prove it because we have no control on the key. So that is the, any question?
Sir, what is a good value for A?
Yeah, that is a good question. So A usually is taking to be a constant. So we can just choose different A and we can see whether this is distributing over the uniformly or not. So that A is typically a constant need to be choose by the designer. So what is the good value of A to know? It depends on, A is statically, A is fixed, then we are having the keys and we are distributing. So we have to choose A beforehand. A is a part of the construction. Yeah, so you can try to choose some A and we can have some key set and then we can see what is the good values of A. Okay. I mean, obviously, if we choose A to be all the zeros, all the ones, so A should have some, I don't know, I mean, we have to check it. Like, what is the good values of that is a good question, but I don't know. We have to check that. We have to choose some A and we have to get some set K, this set of keys, then we have to see again that same A may not be good for other set of keys. So that is the problem. Okay.
Sir, let us say in this modular wheel, if A is not chosen to be a particular value, then all the values in the wheel will not be covered, and after some time the values will start repeating if A is not a good value.
Yeah, so that is the point. So that is again, but good or bad will depend on the set key. Nah? So some A may be good for some set of keys, another A may be good for another set of keys. So that is the issue. So yeah, so you are correct. So you have to choose a such that, but heuristically it is no. What is your question? You mean to say what is the best choice of A? So that we have to find by trial and error method maybe. But that A is the statically we need to fix. I mean A is the part of the construction. So you can say HKA. A you can put it here if you like, because this is A we are choosing beforehand, then we are applying the hash function. Okay.
Sir, what is the size of the wheel?
Because everything we are doing into the 0 to the here, so this is basically A into K. So depending on the K, how much time we are, so if it is 2, then twice we are moving. If it is 3, it is sitting here. If it is 4, it will hit to some other positions. Because ultimately we are doing the mod n. So this is 8, so this will be 0 to 7 like this. So it can be placed in the, so you have a like, you are just rotating like this. Size is 0 to 7, anywhere it can be placed.
Sir, is it always 0 to 7 like?
No, depending on the aim. No, we are choosing R to be 3 over here. So that's why it is 0 to 7. Because ultimately everything will be 2 to the power R. I mean, this will be, so we are putting everything into the size will be our R bit. Okay.
Okay, sir, so the wheel size will be from 0 to 2 raised to power r minus 1.
2 to the power r minus 1, yes.
Okay.
Okay, so this is another example of hash function. This is some randomized strategy we are using. This we will be discussing when we talk about universal hashing or universal hash function. So the idea is, so here, so just to, this will come back again, maybe in the next class, this part. So the idea is here, we choose M to be prime and our keys are very big numbers and we divide it into blocks where each block size is M. M is not a bit, M is the value. So M could be 2 to the power R. Okay. Here R we have taken. So M could be 2 to the power some numbers, 2 to the power some L, 2 to the power some alpha or something like that. So anyway, we are, this value is 0 to M minus 1. Okay. Each of these block values. So this is one key. This is one key. We have a bigger size. So we are dividing this key, we are partitioning this. We are blocking this key into this part. Then we choose a is also this a is a random number, we can say a is also this r this a r plus 1 blocks and each size is m. Then what we are doing, we are just taking the inner product of this. So AI KI, and this when you multiply AI KI, it will be mod, so we take the mod. Or we can take multiply and mod to the whole, that also we can do. Okay, because mod will be, mod can take out in the summation like this. So this is the strategy. So we'll come to this construction when you talk about the randomly chosen hash function, universal hashing. So just to give you an idea, this construction, the key, we break it into the blocks. Each block is maximum M value. And then we are taking a A. A is also, A is A1, A2, or A0, and then A, so this is M minus 1. So don't confuse with this M and the table size. So this is K0 like this, first block, second block like this. So what we do, we multiply this inner product, summation of AI KI. So then we can take the mod, because ultimately our table size is 0 to M minus 1. So this is one example, and this is the function of A also. Because if we choose a vector, it will give us different hash function. This is basically a collection of hash function. We'll come to this construction later stage. Okay. Now the we'll just do this, then we'll stop here. This is what is called another way to handle the collisions, which is called open addressing. Okay. Now, if you recall, how we are handling the collision in our so far. So, if we have a hash function, we have seen some hash function. If we have a hash function like this, and if we have some collision over here, if some keys are colliding here, then so far we know we had a chain. The chaining method, we have a extra storage over here outside the table. It is linked list or array, depending on the, so you have a chain outside the table. Now suppose that is not allowed. So we have everything we have to maintain over here. So we are not allowed to have a extra memory. So no outside storage is used. So everything we have to maintain in a given array. So now the question is how we can handle that. You got the point. So we are not allowed to have the chain outside the table. We are not allowed to have the linked list outside the table or the array outside the table. We have given a array, which is the table basically our. We have given this. We have given an array of size m minus 1. Sorry, array of size m, which is 0 to m minus 1. And everything we have to manage here. We are not allowed to have this chain. We are not allowed to have extra storage. In that case, how to handle collision? Any idea? Yeah, we can use this for our writing. Yeah, so the idea is, you got to the point. So here, we have some, this is our array, 0 to m minus 1.
Sir, what is the open address?
Yeah, that I'll come. So before that, let me just draw this. So we have the some keys, say 55, 65, 79, 2020, some keys of our interest. Okay. Now we have given a hash function, say H. So we map this first, say 55. Now 55 mapped to some slot, so we put 55 over here. Then 65 we map here, say it is mapped to some slot, we put 65 over here. Now 79, suppose 79 we mapped and it is occupying to, it is hitting to collision. I mean it is 79 is going here. So earlier what we used to do, we used to have a chain over here, so it was 55. And then we have another guy to insert there, so 79. So that means we are using some extra memory outside the table, the chain, but now it is not allowed. We are not allowed to have some extra storage. Now tell me how to handle, how to insert 79.
So it sees whether like that 55 spot is occupied, and if it is, then it proceeds to another block within the array only.
So that is the idea. We have to search for a empty slot over here for this 79, because 79 hitting to 55 if we apply this H. So if this is 10, say 10th number, so H of 55, which was 10, and index, which is happened to be now H of 79. So now as you said, we have to search a free slot in this slot. We have to search everything in this table, in this array. So how to do that?
So I guess ideally we'd want something which is not too far from the 55 slot, so that when you're searching for it, you know, after the first try, when it finds it occupied, it moves on to something predictable and closer also.
So that is also a good point. You said that we cannot arbitrarily assign 79 anywhere because we have to search it. So now if we apply again the same hash function, then it will hit to this 55, this 10. So if we have another hash function, say H1, so this is our original hash function, H0, then we apply 79 on H1, then it will hit to some other slot expected. Suppose under H1 it is hitting to again a slot which is 65. So this is H1, say. So this was H0. Then again it is not empty. So again we have to apply another hash function, H2. So we have a sequence of hash functions here. But this is a probe sequence. We have first attempt. First attempt, it is not getting an empty slot. Then we have to go for the second probe. I mean next probe. That is another hash function. Because if you use the same hash function, it will lead to the same slot. So we have to have next hash function. So we have sequence of hash function, probe sequence, and we keep on try until we reach to a empty slot. So suppose H1 it is going there, and now we have to apply another H2. Now suppose it is hitting to here, H2. So H2 of this is 20, and nobody is there in 20. So we just put 79 over there. So this is called probing. Probing means we have a family of hash function instead of one hash function, and we do the probing until we reach to a empty slot. Now how to search? Suppose we are searching 79, how to search? We have some keys, we have inserted this using this probing, using this open addressing. This is called open addressing. Using this open addressing, we have inserted everything over here. Now, how to search 79 after we make this data structure, after we hash everything into this table? How to search 79?
So, we successively call the same hash functions to see what is called, and then we check.
So, we have to follow the same probe sequence. So, if we have to search a key, we first apply the H0, the 0th probe. It will hit to some slot. We check whether that is our key or say not, 79. It is not. Then we go for the next probe. Next probe is hitting this slot, which is 65, which is not 79. Then we go for the next probe. Now, how long will go? Suppose we are looking for a key which is not there. So, how long will go until we reach to a empty slot, right? If it is reaching to an empty slot, nobody is there, then we stop. Now, can you think for, so that is the same probe sequence we have to follow. Same sequence of hashing we have to follow, which we have followed for insertion. Now, can you think for deletion? Deletion is little bit of tricky over here. Now, for example, suppose we want to delete this 65. So, what we do? The way 65 got inserted, we follow the same probe sequence and we reach 65, and suppose we delete this 65 from the table. from our database. Now, can you see a problem if we just delete 65 from the database?
Yes, sir. If after that, I mean, if after 65, I mean, the address pointing to that 65, is there any other element that is after that, then when we search that, then it will give me a blank space that leads to the conclusion that the element is not there, but it is not the case.
So yes. So suppose after deleting 65, if you are searching 79, then what will happen? If you search 79, we first apply 80, it will hit to this slot, which is 55, we check, oh, no, it is not 79. Then we'll again do the next probe, H1, so it will hit to this this slot, but this slot is empty. So we'll straight away say, okay, 79 is not there, which is not correct. So that means when we delete somebody, we should have a mark over here to indicate that it was not originally empty. This room was occupied by somebody, some student, but the student graduated, left the hostel. So it was not originally empty. Somebody was there. So that we can go for next proof, next hash function. So then otherwise we will simply say that 79 is not there in the database. We don't have the record whose key is 79. So deletion is tricky in the sense that we have to maintain, when you delete a node, when you delete a key, we have to maintain some stack over here that this slot was not originally empty. So that is the thing. So this is the idea of open addressing. So we'll have a so now let us have a formally way. So we have a sequence of hash function. So this is now the hash function is a U cross this sequence. So we have a sequence of hash function. And this is also called probe sequence. So we'll first apply the zeroth probe. This is, you can say, 80 of k. So 80 of k we first apply, and if it is hitting to some slot which is empty, we'll insert there. Otherwise we go for next probe, that is this one, h1 of k, you can say. If it is again not empty, then we'll go for the next probe like this. So we have a probe sequence, we have a family of hash function, sequence of hash function. Okay, so now this way we continue, so like this, and every time it will be, so these are the different hash function, you can see. So
Sir, how will we handle the case when the load factor is greater than 1?
Yeah, so that is the basic assumption we need to do. We need to assume this, that this should be, this is our M table size, and this key size is N. So here for open addressing, this is the basic assumption. This should be less than N. Otherwise, we cannot do it. If there are say 100 slot, if there are 200 keys, how we can fit there? If there are 100 slot, if there are 90 keys, we can easily fit there. Or 50 keys, we can try to fit there. Okay. But yeah, you are correct. If N is less than M, then only this is applicable. This is the assumption for open addressing. Thank you. Yeah.
Sir, how can we find a key like in this case?
Yeah, so if we have to find a key there, so suppose we have to find a key, say 79. So what we do? We first apply H0 of, finding a key. So we first apply H0 of k. So that is basically H0 of k. Now first hash function, say it will hit to some slot. We check whether that is 79 or not. It is not. So we, like, it is inserted. That way we have to find. So the same probe sequence we'll do. Same sequence of hash function we have to follow. Then we go for the next hash function, which is H1. So we apply H1 on this. So it will hit here, which is 65, we check that value, no, it is not 79. Then we go, we apply next probe, that is H0, next hash function. So it will hit here, so now we check, oh, this is 79, so we got the key. So this key is in our record, so we can retrieve our record from the original database, something like that. Okay, so that same probe sequence has to follow in order to search.
So it will lead in a linear time, right? In worst case.
Yeah. So that I'll come. We'll come some example of this probing. Then we'll discuss the time complexity. We'll analyze this linear open addressing. Okay. So let us take some example of open addressing. Okay, so this is one example. We have discussed this. So suppose we have some keys. We have some keys which is sitting over here. So these are keys, say 5, 5, 8, 6. So these are keys over sitting here, 1, 3, 3. Okay, like this. Now suppose we have a new key to be inserted. So how to insert? We'll use the first probe sequence. So this is 8-0 of first hash function. I mean 0th hash function or 0th probe, or you can say we are starting with the 0, so 0th probe. Suppose it is hitting to some slot which is not empty, so we have to go for the next probe. So next probe is another hash function, H1 of that. So it is suppose hitting to some slot which is not free, so we have to go for next probe. So like this. So again, suppose it is empty, then we insert this over here in this slot. So everything we have to manage into the same table. So now the search will be same way. So when you are searching, we have to do the same probe sequence. So 0th probe, it will hit to here. Now we check whether this is 498 or not. No, then we have to go for one probe, because we don't know which way we have inserted. We cannot remember that. We cannot store that sequence. Then it will be extra burdensome of that. So that's why you have to go for sequential application of these hash functions. So next we'll go like this. So then we got the point. Okay. So now let us take quick example of the open addressing. First one is linear probing. So linear probing is linear probing is the idea is to, so suppose we are doing this insertion or deletion or so now we have a key to be insert. So we have a hash function h, so we apply this hash function. Suppose it is sitting to some slot h of k. So suppose this is not empty, somebody is sitting here. So suppose this is k2, suppose k1 is sitting here, something like that. So what do we do? What is the obvious step we can think of it? We have to search for a empty slot. So what is the obvious thing we can think of it? Any idea?
So the next slot.
Yeah, we can check the next slot. So that is our H1 of, that is our next hash function, you can say. The next hash function is basically, so H0 is the original hash function. This is H0. H0 is H of k or H prime of k. We have given one hash function. Then if it is hitting here, then we have to go, we check whether this slot is empty or not, the next one. Linearly we are searching. So that is our, instead of applying the different hash function, we just check the next slot whether empty or not. Then if it is not empty, then we have to go for next, like this. So that is the probe sequence. And why we take mod? Because if we are dealing with here, so it will exhaust, then it will come back here. So that's why you have to take mod of this. So is this okay? So this is a example of linear probing. So we have to, so instead of applying the different hash function, we choose a hash function, then we check the next slot like this. But this has a drawback. What is the drawback? This is very simple probing, very simple way to do that, but this has a drawback. Clustering, that means it may happen because we are searching next. If next is empty, then we are putting the value there. So that means there is a chance that in some portion of the table will be fully loaded and remaining are just empty. So it's not uniform hashing, because we are just checking the next one. We are not checking the arbitrary one. We are just checking the next one. If it is empty, we are putting that key over there. Or not, next one, like this. So it is just a clustering over this around a slot which is occupied. So that is a that may create a clustering, I mean, which may not use the all the slots. I mean, there could be some slot which are unused beyond these clustering slots. Okay, so this is not a good hashing in that sense. So linear probing is usually not a. So then we have to go for a next one, which is called double hashing or double probing. So we want to make some arbitrary there. So here we are allowing two hash function, h1 and h2. So what we do? So we have some table. So in the zeroth probe or in the first attempt, if we have a key, so h of k 0. So this you can imagine the h0 of k, the first hash function. It is nothing but h1 of k plus h2 of k. So we have to compute these two hash value, h1 and h2, and obviously mod k in order to put it here. Sorry, this is 0, so this won't be there. So this is, so basically h1 of k. So h1 of k will hit to some slot over here, say I. Now if it is empty, we are happy. Otherwise, we have to go for next probe. So next probe is the another hash function, h1 of k, or next probing. So here we are bringing another hash function. So that is h1 of k plus h2 of k. So it will hit to some slot over here. So if that is not empty again, so suppose it is hitting to some slot J, which is not empty. Then we have to go for the next slot, next probing. So that is another 2. So in that case, instead of bringing a next hash function, we can just multiply 2 over here and we check whether we are getting a free slot or not. So that is the idea. So h of k I is this. So every time we need to take mod in order to get this 0 to m minus 1 value. So this again 3, 4 like this. So instead of I, we can take I square, even we can bring another hash function h3 like this, and they are already computed. So we can make use of that and we can do this probe sequence. So this we have seen heuristically. If we choose m to be prime number and if we choose this h1 and h2 good hash function, then this heuristically have been seen that this is a good hashing, okay, better than the earlier one. But you can have a double, instead of double probing, triple probing, or you can make a square of it. You can have another way of doing that. Just to finish this by analyzing this open addressing, whether open addressing is good or bad, so that we have to see. How much time is left? In the next class. Yeah, so we can analyze this in the next class, open addressing. So let me stop here today. So any questions so far before we stop? We'll analyze this open addressing in the next class. Is this open addressing clear? So we are basically apply this hash function in a probe sequence. So then our goal is to find the empty slot. Once we have an empty slot, we are putting there. So, and the searching will be in a similar way. So this analysis will do how fast this is, or we are doing some more storage or not. Okay, so let me stop. I am stopping the recording.